Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to go ahead and get started. The cast of characters you see in front of you are all that will be with us today, at least for the time being. Mayor Donahue's expected shortly. Thank you. Okay. Welcome to the November 27th City Council meeting. We will begin with the flag salute, and would you please stand and salute the flag with me?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please be seated. Thank you. Councilmember Barrera will not be joining us today, and Councilmember McShane is back east. He is going to be attending the League of Cities, or the National League of Cities conference, that Kimberly and I will be going to tonight. So they will not be here. Mayor Donahue will be here shortly. He is cutting a ribbon. That won't take him long, and he'll be right back. So let's take roll.
Roll call acknowledged.
Great, thank you. We will start with Elizabeth Martinez, our wonderful, fabulous librarian, is going to recognize Brian Kimura.
Thank you, Council. I'm really pleased to honor Brian Kimura. He has donated over 2,000 hours to the Cesar Chavez Library, and for all of the interior design. He's chair of the School of Design at San Jose State University. And we were very fortunate that in late 2009, he came to us and offered his services. He knew that we were planning to explore the possibility, even at that point, of a new library. So he held two community meetings, and he asked the community to envision what a new library would look like. And they came up with a theme, and that theme was agua, water. Water that sustains us, that our bodies, the land, the agriculture, the oceans nearby, and also the growth, not only of vegetables, but of knowledge. So he put all that together in a palette, and over the last few years, he's helped us with all of the interior design of this library. Lately, it's been how many hours a week, Brian, that he has spent with emails and coordinating and interviewing and selecting furniture and specifying furniture. And so when you see that new library, envision the fact that everything in there, the colors, the palette, the furniture, the beautiful modern creation is from Brian Kimura. So I'm very, very pleased that Council can honor him for all of his time, expertise that he's given to the Cesar Chavez Library, to the city. So Brian, please come forward.
Brian, would you like to say a few words?
It has been a pleasure to come to Salinas and represent San Jose State University. I chair the Department of Design. We have well over 1,000 students, and I had a number of my students be involved in the project, which was really exciting for them because it's a real life project. And I used the project in a number of my classes as well. So it was great for model making, doing visual design, and doing conceptual work as well. So the students got a lot out of this project. So I want to again thank Elizabeth for the opportunity to do this work of community service to Salinas. And it's been a pleasure working here for the last couple of years. And I hope to return soon to do more work, actually.
Thank you, Brian, and it's a real heartfelt thank you from this council. If you could come up here and let us each acknowledge you with a handshake, and thank you for all your work. Gloria, I think you'd like to recognize the volunteers for the Veterans Day Parade.
Yes,
Yes, I would, and it's with great honor, especially when it's our employees. It's what a wonderful, wonderful gesture that they are giving back to our community. And I've known Cheryl for probably since I first got elected. I met her in 1994. And I know she's been very, very active with the American Legion post 31. And I am a member of that post. But I read about all the things that she's doing in that post. And it really made me emotional because a veteran, again, we just celebrated Veterans Day. And as some of you know, I have a wounded soldier, a nephew, who's 32 years old and lives in Glendora, and has a prosthesis and other injuries. But when I see all the good things that anyone, any of us do for veterans, it just touches my heart. And you know what? We appreciate everything that you're doing for them. So Cheryl, you're a big star. And I just can't tell you enough how I appreciate everything that you're doing to help the veterans in our community and also in Palo Alto. I know you're a writer and you work so hard for the Teddy Bear Run. And I ask you, the community today, to give back and don't forget the veterans. And if you want to help, contact Cheryl and her group. So this afternoon, Cheryl, I'm acknowledging you and all the group that participated with you in putting together that wonderful Veterans Day Parade. Wasn't it a wonderful event? Yes. And it's a lot of hard work. So Cheryl, can you come up, and the committee members? Because I know there's 1, 2, 3, 4. Yes, there's a total of 5. And again, I appreciate every single one of you, what you have given back to our community. And that the Veterans Parade is just going to be growing and growing every year. So again, I ask you to help the vets. And Cheryl, would you like to say something, or one of the committee members? Oh, she's sick. So one of the committee members, you can go ahead. And thank you so much again.
Right here?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you, folks. And this means a lot from all the people who have served and who are still serving today. We want to recognize them. Veterans Day is every day for me. Mm-hmm. And that day especially, that the country recognizes it, is just an honor, especially for our local vets who can't be here today, who are in harm's way and are paid the ultimate sacrifice. And one thing I like to recognize is it's just Cheryl. And we all wear so many different hats.
Right.
We're volunteers. We're not a professional parade group. Mm-hmm. But we pulled it off. And, man, we did everything.
That's right.
Joe, our chairman, Mr. Phil Orozco,
right.
And Sabas, the everything guy. So
right.
we did it. And a special recognition to our entire committee. There's about 35 of us strong. We're all volunteers. And we do this just out of our heart. And all of us are ties one way or the other with veterans.
That's
and
right.
And just a final note. Families, wives, siblings, they're veterans as well, because
yes.
They sometimes suffer when we're deployed across the country, across the world. So they equally deserve recognition.
That's right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much to all of you. So we're going, if you can come up, we're going to give you a plaque.
Good. Oh, I'm good. Oh, how are you?
We also need to remember the veterans that have fallen. Also, keep them in.
I have the honor of presenting our next City of Champion. And this is a little bit of an unusual City of Champion this time because he doesn't live in Salinas. However, he was born and raised here. He went on to North High, where he was a graduate, and served on the Youth Commission. And I am going to talk for just a minute about James Golden. And I need to tell you this before I start talking about him, is that he said to me yesterday, he said, I'm very humble, and he truly is. So this is going to be difficult, although I hope his family will be, and I know they are very proud of him. James Golden is the author of three books. The first one was Sweet Potato Pie Underneath the Sun's Boiler, for which he won the Langston Hughes Award. He then wrote Afro Clouds and Nappy Rain, for which he won the NAACP Image Award for Outstanding Literary Work. His newest book, which is just being released and is going to have an official release this week, called The Inside of an Orange, a very powerful book of poetry. James Golden's books have been recognized and by the National Steinbeck Center as, and I'm going to quote them, phenomenal works of art. Aside from writing poetry, James has appeared in TV and radio shows. He earned his MPA and his BA in English, Creative Writing, and Pan-African Studies in the Arts and Literature from Cal State University Northridge. He has worked for the last 10 years in Los Angeles. He has he's a writer. His publications include Vibe Magazine, Los Angeles Our Weekly, Clutch Magazine, and Jazz Times. He is, among others, and this is just, believe me, a brief history of a very young man, so it's a good thing. He has been invited to speak at national conferences throughout the nation on hip-hop, gender relations, black male feminism, and cultural medias. His books today, even at his very young age, are being used on high school and college campuses around the country as, and again, this is a quote, hard-hitting, provocative literature. He is in the process of releasing his third book. For such a young man, he is now a nationally recognized poet. This is, in my mind, very exciting because, quite frankly, when we think about who the real artists of the letters are, we have John Steinbeck, and now we have James Golden. And James, it is not only a privilege to recognize you as our champion in this city, but it's a real honor to have you here with your family. And I know you've come up from Los Angeles. You're going to be here doing a number of things, working with some of the high schools. He is going to have a poetry reading on Thursday at our John Steinbeck Library, very appropriate and fitting. And James, I'd like to ask if you'd come up. Well, two things. I'd like you to come up and read one of your poems, and also would you introduce your wonderful family? Many, many, many of us know your family because they've lived in Salinas for so many years, especially your mom who has worked here. But if you could get up and introduce your family and read us a poem, and would you join me in recognizing James Golden?
Okay, thank you. First, I want to, both of my parents are out at work, and my mom's in San Jose, and my dad's busy teaching a class right now, so they're not here, but they would have been here. And today, I'm here with my mom's sisters, Glenda Golden, my aunt Charlotta Williams, my uncle Clifford, and my brother Samson, who's a graduate from North High as well. And I am truly humbled and glad to be back in Salinas for this. I'm just gonna share one of the central poems from the book and one that is extremely important in my life. And these are the things that, when we think about the things that are absolutely concrete in this world and the things that we know for sure, this is what I know for sure. There is a God somewhere near the rainbow top. He frolics with the weather, potting sunshine and darkness. Only one life is given us. Either it will sink or float. Life is a rowboat. There are no emergency exits on Earth. We will all die in an emergency, peaceful or not. Heaven definitely exists, especially when people use love for oars. Regardless, Black kids row through more obstacles than others. Their boats are likely hazardous, needing repair. The inside of an orange is sweeter than anything known. Textured little juice pockets squeeze sunshine from God to our taste buds. The sun will set, even on mighty, mighty Los Angeles September days. The coolness, a kiss, softer than pink cotton candy. But what I know for sure is we have meaning. Our lives are purposed. No mistakes here. There is a God. Thank you.
I'm going to ask James to come up, and I'm just going to remind everybody that Thursday night will be a poetry reading where he will be reading from his new book, The Inside of an Orange. This, I finished it last night. I told James this is a very powerful book, and it's not something you sit down and read in an afternoon. It's a very powerful book and very provocative, and I just am so honored that you are here with us. There's a rumor that James may be writing a poem in honor of Salinas, which hopefully will be in his next book. James? So we will be hearing more from James Golden, not only in this week, but in the months to come as we look forward to his being a part of our poetry celebration and celebration of the arts. Thank you, James, and thank you, family, for coming and joining us today. I have a request that we will allow Assemblyman Alejo 2 to 3 minutes to come on up. Since it's probably for him, and yeah, is it for him?
It's not in the agenda.
Okay, fine. We'll just wait. No, thanks. I'm sorry, Assembly Member. We will definitely wait for Dennis on this one. I thought he'd be here by now. So, all right. So let's move along to public comments. Anyone who is interested in making a public comment, this is the time to do so. 2 minutes per speaker. Please come up and give your comments now. Public?
Good afternoon, Mayor Pro Temp Lutz, City Council members. We have a lot of problems with city council being yay-sayers. You always knock us who come up here and call us names and naysayers. You know, then we have a council member that talks about diversity to bring business to Salinas. You know, what I see in diversity, we do have a lot of diversity in cultures and race, but we also have negative diversity on our roads, in our neighborhoods, in our shopping centers, and every day when we go out and drive around Salinas. Look what's happening. The store owners, the businesses, they have to put extra security in their stores. People, the entitlement people, or people that want, that are considered takers, these people go into the stores, take DVDs, take the DVD out of the case, put it in their purse or coat, and then leave the case. That's just a small example of what's going on. If you're blind to see what's going on in Salinas, you know, we got a progressive mentality, a socialist mentality going on in California. We have it right on our city council every time they meet. We're tired of the yay-sayers. We're gonna fight any new taxes. The taxes, look at your taxes that you're spending on the libraries. You got three libraries in Salinas. Who's going to take care of the Cesar Chavez Library once the fund money runs out, the California Endowment, or all these things? You're building up the cost of living. You're taking taxpayers' money. You know, you got to wake up to reality. Reality's here. California is bankrupt. So is Salinas, becoming soon. Thank you.
Is there anyone else who would like to make a public comment at this time?
Hi. And Mayor, council members, my name is Matt Huerta, and I'm a current planning commissioner and affordable housing advocate. I apologize, I really wanted to stay longer, but I have other commitments. But I wanted to speak to at least one item on the agenda very briefly, and that's the consultant that the city's considering hiring to really nail down the foreclosure crisis and what its impacts have been here in town and going forward and trying to identify some realistic solutions. So just briefly, it's something that I've been really actively involved with for a while. I'm actually the executive director of a nonprofit, Neighborhood Housing Services Silicon Valley. We're a HUD counseling agency, among other things, and we're based in San Jose, but we work all over Silicon Valley, including Monterey. What I'm seeing right now is that there really is a dramatic shift in the foreclosure crisis. It has dissipated to some degree. I think it's important that we really do acknowledge that we're still in the crisis. There's a lot of families that still are suffering the consequences of the crisis. There's really three main populations that are impacted. First, you know, there's folks that, because of the national mortgage settlement that was reached in February nationally, now the states are rolling it out, and also all the servicers, the major banks that were involved, are rolling out their programs. There's a big push, and it's really necessary for the city to get involved however it can, as far as supporting the advocates, to make sure that families know what their rights are, what their opportunities are directly with the banks, and then also with HUD counseling agencies, other resources, because there is some justice out there to be had for folks that were improperly foreclosed and mistreated. But you have to seek it out and you have to play the game. So there's a lot of advocacy that needs to happen there. Intervention, as part of that, there's loan modifications and principal reductions that the banks are required to do. So that's another part of the piece of the puzzle here. And finally, there's other agencies involved here in town that are part of cleaning up the mess, the disposition side of making homes available, not for just investors, but actually for the families that can take advantage of the lower priced homes. So there's obviously a lot of things on the table. I look forward to being part of identifying those solutions, but I think you are taking, hopefully, the right measure here in hiring the right consultant to identify the issues and then also bring in additional advocates to the table. Thank you.
Anyone else?
Mary Ann Warden. For some of you, this will probably be the last time you'll see me in front of here. And be thankful that I'm not here to chew you out, but it really has been an honor and a pleasure to serve this city council, and I've learned a lot. You know, this is over 20 years. I've been four mayors that I've served under, and it really has been an honor and a privilege, even though we don't always agree, and you've taken my chewing out gracelessly, and I respect that, and I respect all of you all. But I just want to say thank you, and it really has been a great honor to serve under all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary Ann. Anyone else?
Good afternoon, council members. I'm Bill Carruthers, and I have some good news for you. There has been price appreciation across the board for every district, every area measured in Monterey County, except one. And that was only because there were only two sales in the whole district. so forth. The number of properties that are upside down, in other words, have a negative equity, declines as prices go up. the underlying root problem of all of this foreclosures and so forth and storm and drang and so forth is evaporating very slowly, but it's the best news I've had to share with you in a long, long time.
Thank you. Anyone else?
These are the signs that are laying around in our neighborhood. Thought I'd come and pick them up, get them off the street so that they're not in violation of the law. You used my cousin's murder for your own selfish interests to raise tax on people who are already overburdened. I'd like the city council to investigate the battery by Dennis Donahue on my person. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Good evening, Council. Mr. Mayor, my name is Amit Pandya. I'm the president of Old Town Salinas Association. I'm here with three things today. Number one, approximately a month ago, there was a fast developing parking situation in Old Town in 100 block. We said the exact same thing. City staff followed up on that issue at a speed of business. Within a 7 to 8 day period, we had planned, we had signs, we had approval for a whole slew of resources that our merchant had asked for. And on behalf of the merchants, I would like to say thank you to the city for making that happen. Number two is we come 2-3 days away from the annual Parade of Lights. This is an event that happens every year. This year we had record crowds, estimated between $32,000 to $35,000 for 30 people. I'm a businessman, money on my mind, right? And the crowds actually didn't stop at Steinbeck. They went down center, and then they came across Salinas all the way to Gabilan. And it was a wonderful event, and partially was made possible through cooperation with the city. A third issue I come to talk about, hopefully we'll get some cooperation from city in resolving this, and that would be the homeless issue in Old Town, brought to forefront by an incident just recently. This is an incident that Old Town Board has talked about, homelessness issue. We have come to the study sessions with the council. The issue is there, homeless issue is real. We understand it's multifaceted and it's deep and varied, and there is no immediate solution. But we urge the council to work with OSA merchants and other people in the city to perhaps come to a conclusion a little bit sooner than later, because the merchants are now understandably jumping up and down at a faster pace. Thank you.
Thank you. Marianne, you've already been up here.
I'm sorry to come against, up again, but again, Marianne Horton, but I need to clarify something. So the whole city understands that none of you took advantage of my son for your campaign. That was something I wanted to do for Measure V and for the fire department and the police department.
Thank you,
ma'am. Because it was the fireman that saved my son's life long enough so we could talk to him and had 2.5 months with him.
Thank you, Marianne.
Without the fire department to do that and the officers that did their job, some of the other people in our thing did not do their job, but those people that took care of him right off the bat did it. And when I was asked, I said I'd be proud to have my name there. So Just want to clarify, because okay. Everybody listens, you know, to you people, and I get stopped in the stores. I want to clarify.
Thank you, Marianne.
And I did not use my son. Okay?
Thank you. Thank okay. You. Anybody else? Okay, then I'm going to close the public comment. I am just going to go back to let you know that the Hebron Family Center Recreation Programs has been continued to a future date. We will move now to the Community Safety Division, and we will receive a report from Georgina Mendoza, our Community Safety Division Director.
Thank you, Mayor and Council Members. It is my pleasure to come before you today and inform you and give you an update of all the positive things that are occurring in our community, in our division, in our city, in CASP, the Community Alliance for Safety and Peace. I was told to only have a few minutes to discuss highlights throughout the year. However, I'm afraid I'm starting in August, since the latest report I said I was going to give to you all was on the latest federal visit from our federal representatives. That last federal visit was in August of this year, the 15th and 16th. This is the third federal visit from our representative colleagues since 2010, when the city of Salinas was first invited to participate in the National Forum on Youth Violence Prevention. Our federal partners come to see what kind of strategies and programs we're implementing, seeing if they're evidence-based, if they're successful, and if so, they want to know how they can help. If there's areas that do need some extra assistance, then they're also here to help us with resources. A number of positive things came from that visit. The partners that came were included those that are on the slide, Theron Pride from the Department of Justice, Office of Justice Programs. He is the head of the National Forum on Youth Violence Prevention. He actually specifically asked to come to Salinas because he wanted to see the work that he had only heard about in D.C. Gregory Joy, also from the DOJ, who's our point of contact, came to visit us. Melinda Haig, our U.S. attorney for the Northern District of California, also came to visit us from San Francisco. Ron Ashford from HUD in D.C., as well as Nancy Flores from HUD from the San Francisco Division, came to visit our city. Brian Darr from DOL came, Marcy Hertz from the Center for Disease Control, Sharon Burton from Department of Ed, and Rachel Davis, who is the Director of Prevention Institute. We put them up there so that you can recognize the names, know who came, but also to demonstrate the diversity of departments that came and visited our city, and really how we kept them busy. I'll give you an example. Ron Ashford and Nancy Flores are now working with our local communities, including our division, our housing authority, Sun Street Centers, and our community residents in creating housing workshops, because that is something that they asked, our community residents asked them, is that something you can help us? We need more information, we need more education, so let's work together. That's a fine example of local people, resident people working with different departments all the way up to the national level. Marcy Hertz from the Centers for Disease Control came representing CDC and came to see the work that is being done under the STRIVE grant. The STRIVE grant was awarded to the County of Monterey. It is now housed in the Public Health Department, where I will show you the figures of just how much money was provided for that, again, for the good of the Salinas community. With the assistance of Sharon Burton, we met with the Department of Education, Monterey County of Education, and a number of other school superintendents throughout the city. One of the asks that was made from our locals' education representatives was to have a PBIS program. That stands for Positive Behavioral Interventions and Supports. It is very successful, it's evidence-based, and it's proven to have significant impact. Salinas is one of just two cities in the National Forum that actually implement PBIS in our city. With the assistance of this new collaboration that we have, we are working with the Department of Education to bring in extra resources so that we may implement this very successful strategy into other schools in Salinas. I'll talk very briefly about what their visit looked like, because they were kept very busy. It started at 7 in the morning with a CAS meeting, the Community Alliance for Safety and Peace. I see some CAS members here, you may recall. I'm looking at you, Nick, and now how we really kept them busy and said, this is who we are. We're over 70 agencies, a number of representatives there, and we all commit to meeting at least twice a month, every month at 7 in the morning, to show our commitment and how we can pool our resources strategically to make a positive impact in Salinas. So they were able to see that. Afterwards, we took them to the Law Enforcement Operations Center, where we met with the U.S. Attorney, the District Attorney, the Sheriff, the Police Department, and showed them how we collaborate successfully with members from FBI and other, the Gang Task Force and other law enforcement agencies. We then gave them a tour of Closter Park. Councilmember Tony Barrera was there, as well as Anna Foglia, who was wearing two hats as director of Sun Street Centers, as well as Rotarian hat, and really showed them the positive work that can be done when we work together with the community. She explained to them that residents of that neighborhood wanted to see Closter Park be somewhere where they felt safe enough to work together, to play, and to simply be outdoors and enjoy and make it feel like it's their own. With the help of the Rotaries and very committed individuals, they were able to reform, not reform, but to really redesign the park and now have a kiosco, which is very popular and widely seen throughout villages and towns in Mexico, where people just gather around, especially on Sundays after church, right across the street, and just kind of hang out. They were able to meet with some residents who said, oh, now we can sit here and look at everybody coming in and out. So can you please bring us more benches? I said, okay. They said they felt safer. We then had a press conference that was very well attended. The media did an excellent job of covering it. And we had lunch. We had lunch with residents from the neighborhood. We had lunch with elected officials and a number of people that just wanted to share their concerns and also show off a little bit of the good things that are going on in Salinas. Afterwards, we talked more specifics about STRIVE and how the health department and other city and county governments can work closer together to ensure that we're implementing everything that the STRIVE grant requires. That always takes coordination and collaboration. Finally, it did end with educational roundtable, which is what I briefly discussed about PBIS. That was just day one. Day two, they went to Hartnell College to see the NASA program. I don't know if any of you are familiar with it or which of you are familiar with it, but this is exciting. This is the Science, Engineering, Mathematics, and Aerospace Academy. Only one of, I believe, 14 sites or so throughout the nation. The only one in California. The closest one to us is in Texas. Why? Because they saw promise and positive resources here in Salinas and know that this is a place worth investing in. We then took them to see a cross-functional team, and that is a action task force from CASP. And essentially what we do there behind closed doors, it is a confidential meeting, is discuss particular cases of young people that are at high risk and that have had some problems. And we have about 16 different agencies that are part of this. So we actually do wraparound services. We do case studies. So if we get a referral, for example, from a police officer, they don't simply arrest a young person and throw him somewhere that maybe won't be as beneficial. Instead, they talk to them, they let us know what's going on, and 100% of the time, every time we talk to them, there's problems in the home. We usually see problems of substance and alcohol abuse, domestic violence, or sometimes just having so many people living under one roof, where one child in particular said, I sleep a few hours on the couch, and that's all the time I have by myself. So this is where we really get to discuss the details and help them. So it's prevention and direct intervention. So they were able to see that. We then broke off into informal lunch discussions where all of these federal representatives just sat in different places and had a comfortable conversation with community residents. That's actually how the Housing Committee and Housing Workshops came to be. residents said, this is what we need, this is what's important to us, please make it happen. And that's exactly what we're doing, again, on every level. We then met with the faith-based community, where we discussed night walks, where although a lot of clergy is involved in this, it's really open for anyone who wants to do something positive for the community. Night walks are run by volunteers, where they go to the most affected areas during the highest peak of crime. And we base that on the data given to us by the police department saying, these days at these times is where you see the highest crime. Based on that, they go on walks. We did receive training by Reverend Jeffrey Brown and Pastor Eddie Caraveo, one of them from Boston, the other from Sacramento, who have been doing this type of work for 20 years or so and have proven to be a successful prevention strategy. We did also give them a Hebron neighborhood tour led by our council member, De La Rosa, where she was able to show them, this is the community, this is why we work so hard. And she introduced them to a number of individuals, to a business, which is really funny. Council member, you recall, we took him to a tire shop where you had a number of people, police officers, the chief, a number of federal representatives stop by to say hi to a mechanic. And he just was like, oh, hi, I'm trying to put some tires on. And we're like, okay, we don't want to disturb you. But it was just kind of interesting and very cool, I think, for them to see just how good our residents are and how hardworking they are. Council member De La Rosa also took him to meet some of the victims of the shooting that happened July 11th with the three farm workers. So they were able to see directly what kind of impact that can have and really put a face to the name. So that is one of the main purposes for them coming here. We then also took them to the youth council, where they got to see, and that's the picture over on the right, the youth council that we have here in Salinas, which has members ranging from middle school all the way up to Hartnell College. And they were there to say, we want to be a positive influence in Salinas. We're tired of being seen as young people only do bad things and only having a bad reputation. We also have positive things to add. So we thought it was very powerful for them to see that. As a result, we did, as I mentioned briefly, have public housing workshops now, expansion of night walks, enhancement of prevention strategies in the strategic work plan through the STRIVE grant, and partnerships with MCOE and Department of Ed, specifically implementation of PBIS. Very quickly, I'll talk about just some of the funding sources that we've received in the last year. So private funding, really important. You see things like $2,000, $500, et cetera. That's extremely helpful for when we were doing our Leadership Academy, the first ever Leadership Academy, because grants, and frankly, my division cannot cover things like food, childcare, bilingual devices and services, all those things that you really need to have a successful community meeting. So we really want to thank those folks, PG&E, Driscoll, and Community Foundation, for the assistance in that. The $10,000 grant that you see up there was given to each of the participating forum cities because Target was and continues to be impressed by the work that the young people are doing in the forum cities. Therefore, that $10,000 grant went directly to the Youth Council, both co-chairs who work under the Boys and Girls Club. State funding, we've been successful, thankfully, every time that we apply to the state fund, and that's CalGRIP, the Gang Reduction Intervention Prevention Funds. The latest one, just to talk about the ones from this year, are CalGRIP, what we refer to as 3, 4, 5, and 6. I believe actually CalGRIP 6 was in the consent agenda for approval. And as you see there, there are significant amounts, totaling just this year alone, 1.425 and some change. And that again is each award lasts about 2 years, where we've been able to do a number of different things, including, excuse me, okay, I'm doing this wrong. Sorry, I'm not wearing my glasses. Can you do this? Where is it? Oh, there we go. Okay, forget it. So again, just the state funds about 2 years each, covering things from evidence-based programs, dealing with parenting programs, dealing with strengthening families, as well as covering things like Second Chance, Partners for Peace, and Sun Street Centers, which provide treatment and assistance with drug and alcohol abuse. The latest one, CalGRIP 6, again, will help expand the hours of the Hebron Family Center and the Bread Box for Saturday nights. Again, this is in response to something that the youth asked for. They said, we want to be able to do something Saturday nights. There's nothing to do in Salinas. What can we do? So this was in direct response to that. And again, those are just examples. CalGRIP 6 will start January 1st of next year and will end December 31st of 2014. The one that I skipped was the federal funding. Kind of a big slide that Patty is going to help me with. Thank you. And I'll go really quick. It's just two grants. One that, again, is on for, thank you, it's that one, Patty. Thank you so much. This is just within the last 2 months. So I just really wanted to put that in bold, that in just 2 months from federal funding, we were able to receive $624,998. We didn't include the 98 cents. And $125 will go from the OJJDP. We got as a result of being a participant in the National Forum. That will all go towards evaluation of our strategic work plan. It's being conducted by Dr. Angela Wolf, who is a respected researcher throughout the nation and who works for the National Council on Crime and Delinquency. She will be bringing two other staff who will be looking at our strategic work plan that we developed in 2010 and which will be ending in terms of implementation this year, next month. And she will be letting us know through her research what's working, what isn't, what should we continue doing, or what should we enhance on, or perhaps what we should stop doing, why certain challenges perhaps weren't able to be met, and how they could be met, so that now as we move forward in updating our comprehensive plan that will actually be for 5 years, 2013 to 2018, we'll be able to make sure that it becomes even more successful. The Project Safe Neighborhoods, if you all recall, we had Melinda Haig and Anne-Marie Conroy from the U.S. Attorney's Office in San Francisco come and announce that we were the recipients of $500,000, again, for the good work that is being done in this community. So just in the last 2 months from the federal government, you see that we have that amount. These are just two examples of the work that our partners have received. We touched briefly on STRIVE, which is a total of 1.125 or 250,000 per year for 5 years. And again, that all goes towards prevention to be centered in Salinas. Rancho Cielo Youth Corp Youth Build Program received $1 million. Something that they both have in common is that these applications were submitted as part of a collaborative. They said, we're part of CASP, the Community Alliance for Safety and Peace, and we're doing this in furtherance of a comprehensive strategic plan, inevitably really putting them in a very good position, competitive position to really apply for this. So just those two, just two examples of our collaborative partners is over $2 million. So, and just this past year, just including two other examples, we've been able to get from grants, private, state, and federal, a little over $4 million, and we are not stopping. So I just want to say that we are receiving that because we do work well together, we are committed to it, and we are strategic about the way that we spend it. So I'm available for any questions.
Okay, thank you, Georgina. Anything to my right? Anything to my left? Public.
Good evening, Mayor, City Council. On this, this is a prime example of what's going on in California, the black hole. We're good in bringing business in on these kind of programs. You know, why are we bankrupt? Why are we having problems financially? Good God. All this money going down that black hole, and you and the progressives think, oh, it's good. Look at California. Damn. I can't believe it. 12 years I've been here, and it's been getting worse every year.
Okay, thank you, Bill. Anyone else?
Thank you.
Okay, back to us. Just a quick comment, Georgina, well done. And I relative to our wanting to become a more peaceful city, there are a lot of moving parts and a lot of different roles. You know, the chief would tell you, I've got to, on a day-to-day basis, I gotta go get him, and he has his role, the community has their role, and I think your office, the role is to deliver a message, establish, for lack of a better phrase, a brand, a collaborative, a way of doing business, and create kind of a force multiplier. And I think you've done that with your office. Collaboration and cooperation, and reaching out to our state and federal partners, you know, to take your office and bring in $4 million around the structure for peace, which creates the process by which we can succeed together. I think it's good work, and that's your role, and your office is doing that. So I think it's a job well done, and as I said yesterday, the fact that the council has an opportunity to—I think it's a bit of a chip shot to say, "Will you or won't you accept $500,000?" I mean, I'm pretty sure I know that I didn't have to count too many votes on that, but those are significant grants in this era. So, and our recent history says they'll be put to good use. So, good work, and thank you.
Thank you, Mayor.
Good.